today we are going to do infrastructure. Again, remember that I feel that teaching infrastructure can be quite boring. You could have to say, well, we do power, we do road, we do railways, we do telecom, and say this went up, this went down, etc., etc. And so the challenges again here, how do you make these subjects come alive? In principle, you could also add road, telecom, etc. And I think telecom is an interesting example in another sense, which I'll just come to. Okay, first, I think the way I would introduce infrastructure is to say, these are public utilities, electricity, water, railways, etc. These require large capital investments, we know, high fixed costs, economies of scale, long gestation periods. And also, increasingly, we see now a new dimension to this in the last 20 years, especially with telecoms and now with Facebook and data. There are network effects, i.e., the value of something increases the more people that are part of these networks. And that also gives rise to tendencies to monopolization. So all these things tend to make public utilities monopolies. Now, again, that's not a hard and fast. There are exceptions to this. But broadly, I think that is a kind of characterization of public utilities. So the dilemma is this, right? In the past, we used to have all of these things being in the public sector. And then we said, well, if you have them exclusively in the public sector, we have inefficiencies. So let's try, if we can also bring in the private sector. But then if you bring in the private sector, you have other challenges as well. There can be monopoly profits, there can be high prices, there can be poor service. There can be monopolistic behavior. So how do we then deal with that? So essentially, the essential dilemma for public utilities is that we want somehow to harness the efficiency of the private sector, but without foregoing, without giving away or incurring some of the costs that could come with that. So this whole public sector, private sector dilemma is always going to be there with natural monopolies. Just a bit of history, as I said, even in India, our industrial policy resolution said, we will occupy the government, the state will occupy the commanding heights, and the commanding heights certainly included being on top of telecom towers, but then, of course, at that time, there were no telecom towers, but commanding heights certainly included all the utilities. But we know what happened with public sector ownership. And so what happened, certainly in the early 80s, we had a combination of ideology. These were the three people who really led the charge in privatizing some of the public sector monopolies. All of us know about the Reagan and Thatcher revolution, but many of the most innovative experiments in this were actually done by Chile under the General Pinochet. And so it's a combination of the experience with public sector inefficiency combined with a change in ideology, but also combined with a change in technology. What we thought had to be done in the public sector certainly changed with technology. Best example is telecom. We thought that it all had to be done fixed lines, public sector, and then we got wireless and so on. And that changed a lot about how we think about we should do this. So in some senses, the way the world has moved into this is that we get less public ownership, but more and more public regulation of the private sector. So that's how, the world is trying to. We have telecom, we have the Telecom Regulatory Authority, power, we have the CERC, environment, we have an environmental regulator. Now railways, for example, we're going to get a rail regulator. The government has recently passed legislation saying there's going to be a rail regulator. So what we try and do is that we try and get more private sector into these public sector utilities, but we have to balance them with having better regulation because this is a sector that naturally tends towards monopolization. Is now more and more used a lot in research, but also this shows, these are night lights from NASA. And At one level, this is amount. This tells you a lot about, you know, the power sector, you know, how lights have increased. But more and more research is now using this as a proxy for, you know, GDP growth, welfare advances. So night lights are a very hot topic in development research. They're used as proxies for all kinds of things. Let me just say, for my two pennies worth, in writing this survey, we also thought we would use these night lights data to see whether we could get better and more high frequency, you know, information on state level performance. Is it the case that, you know, the states within India, you know, given that the data come with a 2-3 year lag, given we don't know how, you know, how reliable these state level data are, we tried to use this, you know, to see whether, you know, it kind of fitted state level data, and we were a little bit disappointed actually. So if you're going to use this night lights data to do research, I would. One problem with, I mean, there are lots of issues with night lights data. The one thing that always strikes me about night light data, if you look there, is that, you know, places like, you know, Mumbai and Chennai, which are close to the sea, somehow they don't show up as, you know, kind of big and bright as they should. You know, to me that, you know, it's a little bit puzzling, for example, why this and this are not, you know, much, much brighter than this area. I mean, this is the, you know, what we did yesterday, the kind of the, you know, Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, Jharkhand, that kind of area. And I mean, the notion that Mumbai and Chennai should be, you know, similar or less bright than that, you know, a little bit, it makes me a little bit skeptical about this data. But this shows what has happened in night lights. I mean, under this government, a number of achievements have been made on the power sector. And I'm going to come to that in a second, but these are, you know, very important achievements that have been made. I want to take you to some interesting facts about the power sector. India is the world's largest electricity producer. It's the fourth largest consumer. Per capita consumption is still very low, about 1,000 kilowatt hours compared to, you know, 13 times that in the US, despite having cheap tariffs. And of course, out of the 1.4 billion people with no access to power, India accounts for 30 million. This is, you know, sources are given here. But as I said, in the last, you know, 3 years, we've had a very strong addition to capacity. And you see that access, percentage of population with access to power, India is behind the BRICS countries. And across the states, you see the same access to power. You know, you see there on the states, you know, the poorer states are indeed those states with less electricity. And someone yesterday was asking me, remember we did yesterday, I showed you in one of those research things, we used transmission and distribution losses as a proxy for institutional capacity. Well, it turns out to be a proxy for institutional capacity in a kind of metaphorical sense, but it's also literally correlated with how much power there is available to the people in those states. But you know, but Delhi, Goa, Chandigarh have attained pretty good access levels. Transmission and distribution losses, as you can see, India there is up there, is pretty high. Compared to BRICS peers, it's improved over time, but it's still, you know, about 15, maybe a little bit more. But this is transmission and distribution losses. But we measure this, you know, also in a slightly different way. It's called ATC losses, aggregate technical and commercial losses. They include technical losses, theft, and also commercial losses due to non-payment of electricity bills. And what we see here is that, you know, again, you go towards the right, you see states with pretty high, and you see Jammu and Kashmir is amongst the less well-performing states. And again, you see the same UP, West Bengal, Orissa, Bihar, Jharkhand, MP, Rajasthan, bringing up the less progressive part of this. So AT&C losses are very high in India, and this is a big part of the problem. Now, just again, some interesting facts. So just to give you an example, today, thermal represents 67% of capacity, hydro 14, and renewable 17. But we know that given the Prime Minister's commitment, in about 20 years, this one is going to represent a much bigger fraction of India's capacity. Could be even, I don't know, 30% or so. In terms of generation, a surprising thing is that the private sector now is about 44%. If you had done this number calculation, say even 10 or 15 years ago, this would have been virtually, almost nothing at all. It's increased a lot because we brought in the private sector via PPP projects to generate power after 2003 when we passed the Electricity Act. But the power sector is fascinating because it raises a number of issues about, conceptual issues about how we should do this in principle, and of course how we should, what the challenges are. So broadly, as you know, in power, there are three stages to the process. There's generation, there's transmission, and there's distribution. So three stages, each with its own kind of rich set of issues that it raises. Now, so this is just to give you a sense of the whole historical evolution in this. So we have, before 2003, basically we had monopoly in government monopoly in generation, that's G, government monopoly in transmission, and government monopoly in distribution. That's how we began before. After the Electricity Act of 2003, and after we brought in the private sector via PPP projects, we noticed that this has changed. One, competition has been brought in. We have a power generation now, both by the public and the private sectors. But in some sense, the only choice available here is to the distribution and retail company because they have a choice of who to buy it from. So this is basically where we are here, and we are in transition to this third phase where we are going to get also competition in this sector where we're going to, we should have had many here, right? So we should, so we're going to get potentially competition in distribution as well, so that then both, you'll have a choice in terms of who you buy it from, and also who sells it to you, so there'll be more choice. Consumers will then have choice. At the moment, the choice is only with the distribution companies. So essentially, we've moved from here to here, and we're in transition here, where we've brought in the private sector and competition in terms of generation, and the next stage is to bring in, and we call this open access, because basically, you have a choice of who you can buy it from. Now, a couple of things that certainly I wasn't aware of, until we did this thing, is that the interesting thing is that we do now have a sort of a market for, a high frequency market for power. So in the sense that even today, buyers who need more than 1 kWh, in principle, they can go to what's called a power exchange, where power is sold and bought on a daily basis. This today, it accounts for about 4% of total power. In an ideal situation, more and more people will want to buy power from this exchange rather than being, and I'm going to show you, rather than getting power through alternative means. So as we moved from this monopoly at every stage, we have also set up regulators for the power sector. We have, in the case of power, because power is a state subject, we have both a central regulator and a regulator in each of the states. The regulators do many things, including fixed tariffs, the final tariffs for consumers. So we're seeing a kind of broadly consistent with what's happened internationally. We are slowly moving and bringing in the private sector into this sector, which was initially, at least until 15 years ago, entirely dominated by the public sector. Yeah. Well, so the question is, remember, I think essentially we still think that the transmission thing, there's still a huge number of fixed costs, but even there we're getting elements of competition there. But I think that world over, distribution it can be competitive in places. Navu, you want to add something? In the mic.
So the thing is that the wire businesses are supposed to be natural monopolies, but the retailing part can be done by like different companies. So there as well, the idea is that retailing will be done by different companies, but the wire business still will be owned by a natural monopoly.
So this is where we are in terms of the structure. One question. Comment.
This pricing of the for the retailers is a problem in the private sector because it is regulated. So the generation is dependent upon the prices.
We'll come to prices in a second. So which leads us to the next thing is, this is the institutional structure. You see, in generation, we have state generating companies. We have NTPC, which is the national generating companies. We have independent, that's the private sector. But we also have captive plants. That's the, there are companies which do their own generation. You need to get permission for that, but that's another. And then transmission, we've shown. And distribution, of course, we have the state DISCOMs. But increasingly, certainly in some cities, we know that in Delhi and Mumbai, we also have private companies which are distributing power. And I spoke about the power trading companies and power exchanges that in principle, some buyers and some sellers can interact on a high frequency basis. Currently, I'm told that in this, kind of high frequency market for power, that accounts for about 4% of the total power that is bought and sold in the country. And then you have, of course, the final consumers. Now, the interesting thing here is also, what is the contract structure in power? Essentially, we have, I think, broadly two kinds of contracts. One is the long-term contracts, and 90% of power is based on that. So specific sellers and specific buyers enter what are called PPAs, power purchase agreements, for 12 to 25 years, and it's based on all kinds of, I don't know how they price over 25 years, but they do. It's a pretty kind of hairy, complicated business. And then, of course, you have more short-term pricing, but that accounts for about the short-term contracts are 5%. And of course, this power exchanges, which is the kind of almost daily selling and buying of power, is about 4%. So long-term contracts are still a very big component of the power market in India, and it's beginning to create a lot of complications, one of which I will explain in just a moment. Now, what are the challenges in this sector? And I think it's a fascinating sector. We explored some of these challenges in the economic survey of last year. But I'm going to go through, say, four or five or six major challenges that this sector faces. So can anyone guess what this is? A tariff schedule of, not an electricity board, this is a tariff schedule set by a regulator, one of the state regulators. It's astonishing that, if you were to go and buy petroleum or toothpaste or some other essential, I mean, you take it for granted that if it's one market, it's one price. Why is it that in this case, we have, 70, 80, 90, and I'll show you some of the absurdities in this. There is, for example, there is for a mushroom and rabbit farm, there is a separate tariff. Wetland farmers greater than 2.5 is something. Wetland farmers less than 2.5. Can you imagine the nightmare complexity of implementing this? Seasonal industries off season. Pisciculture, prawn culture is one. Sugarcane crushing is another. So this is mind-bogglingly complex. And we know that, the reason this is there, it cannot be a good reason because you cannot distinguish all these things. You should not distinguish all these things. And yet we have this mind-boggling complexity. So what is it about power? See, for me, something like this, when I see this, it makes me really both astonished but also very angry. But when I find that all of you are not angry enough, that makes me even more angry. So this is, I mean, it's astonishing. No market do we think that there should be 800 or 100 prices for the same product, and yet we, and this is true for almost, I mean, again, maybe I should go to another state and commit the same faux pas, but then, you know, but we know that this is happens almost in every state. We have such mind-boggling complexity, and for sure, this gives rise to a lot of corruption. There's no question about it. But there's nothing that, you know, prevents the state regulator from saying, you know, simple, let's just make 65. You know, you want to have some differentiation, but you don't have to have this complexity. In fact, very recently, the power minister has taken up this issue, and there is going to be some coordinated effort at, reducing the complexity. You know, so I think this is, I mean, for me, when I first saw this, when my team did this research, it was both a very interesting, but also something that I think we can work on by way of policy. But anyway, so this is one, you know, simple but actually very important reform that can happen quite easily. So the second thing, of course, is we all know, and what has given rise to, to one of the new schemes that the government implemented 2 years ago, we know that the classic case is that, you know, distribution companies face huge losses. And again, you see that the states which have the highest losses are, you know, familiar, UP, Rajasthan, Tamil Nadu, Madhya Pradesh, so on. You know, why we have these losses relates to the question that the gentleman asked. But certainly we can look at, this is one of the big challenges. And the way it works, of course, it's like almost everything in India, whether it's railway tariff, power tariff, or the GST, or we try and use pricing as a tool for changing income distribution. So for example, what we do is that on the right-hand side, you see agriculture and domestic, we try and keep the tariff low. But you know, once you do that, you have to charge higher tariffs on other sectors. And this is what's called cross-subsidization. And this cross-subsidization, of course, we can't do it fully because that would make industrial tariffs, railway tariffs, commercial tariffs too high. And so we end up both, you know, cross-subsidizing and making losses because, you know, if you cross-subsidize fully, I mean, your industry would become completely uncompetitive. So challenge one, complexity. Challenge two, losses. Losses in turn arise because, the key thing is that we try and meet our social equity objectives, our inequality objectives, by charging low prices for domestic and for agriculture. And often, of course, in many states, this is an average across India. So in many states, for example, this would be zero, like, for example, in Punjab, correct? So this is a consequence of that. This plot shows you cross-country comparison. On the x-axis, you see tariffs, industrial tariffs, and this is in terms of megawatt hour, not kilowatt hour. You see that if you measure tariffs in PPP terms, India is the most expensive here. So you measure, you know, this is how expensive here, and this goes expensive here. If you measure it in terms of PPP dollars, India is very expensive. Even if you measure it at market exchange rates, India is kind of in the middle here. But the thing is that the color of the dots is meant to tell you what matters is not just the price, but whether it's interrupted or uninterrupted power. So the red basically tells you the quality of electricity supply. That's, therefore, if you adjust the tariff by the quality of power supply, you will find that India is has very high tariffs adjusted for quality and for continuity, and which of course contributes significantly to making Indian industry, especially those that are electricity intensive, textiles, for example, steel, for example. These are all very power intensive sectors, and they become highly uncompetitive because of this policy. So if you use, one lesson is that if you use prices, you know, for multiple objectives, you know, you generally end up not meeting any of those objectives. because we know what happens even in terms of, we saw even in terms of trying to give free power to the agricultural sector, we know that there is kind of, from the data that we have, given that consumption is mostly by the big farmers, you know, even in terms of attaining that equity objective, we don't end up fulfilling that. Now, this is the comparable thing across the states. You find that the red ones, you know, as you go up, are the ones that are getting high tariffs for industry. And you see that Tamil Nadu is also a state which has actually, even though it's an advanced state, it has high and poor quality of power supply. Even Kerala, for example, Karnataka, Kerala, they all seem to be, so this is a cross-state chart of this. Now, if that complexity chart makes my blood boil, I think this chart actually makes my blood boil as much. I was aghast, I was shocked when we did this research, that in India today, remember yesterday, Dil Hai Hindustani, are we one market for taxes? We're trying to become one. Are we one market for agricultural commodities? We saw that we're not. But it turns out that we're also not one market for electricity. If a company in one state wants to buy power from another state, it has to pay what are called cross-subsidy charges. That is, over and above the normal tariff, you have to have. So I don't know, sir, I don't know whether I know you don't believe in free trade internationally, but I wonder whether you believe in free trade within India or not. But certainly in the case of power, we don't have free trade within India, which I think makes a mockery of India as one economic market. And really, some of these charges are quite high. So for example, Tamil Nadu, for example, maybe when you're sitting in the Amba canteen, there will be no power. Maybe you get the food, but no power. What happens is that these numbers, you know, if you look at something like 3.5 cross subsidy, this is over and above whatever the 5 or 6 paise you may have to pay. This is on top of that. Yes. Yeah. So Navu, you want to say something? The mic, please.
Current market rates are around 2.5 rupees.
Yeah.
So you have to pay 3.5 rupees. This is like 100% tax.
More than 100% tax. So think of it this way. Supposing we said that to get, say, soap or shampoo, I don't want to get into which states you have. You know, you bathe most often. I don't want to get into those sociological things. But if, for example, someone living in Kerala wanted to buy soap from, Tamil Nadu, if you said no, you'd have to pay 150% extra tax if it comes from thing. How would we think about that in India? I mean, if you live in Haryana and you get something from Delhi, you have to pay 150% extra tax over and above. How would you feel? But that's exactly what we do in power. So this is something that came as a real surprise to me. So the question is, what is the genesis for this? And see, the reason is very clear, that because if you then allowed a company in a state to buy from another state, then you could not sustain your own cross-subsidization. And that's what leads to, you know, if you want to keep the cross-subsidization domestically, because then, of course, you'll have nobody will buy from domestically, and then you will get into a spiral where your distribution companies become totally bankrupt. So this is actually a response to a consequence of wanting to maintain crop subsidization within the state. Yeah, question for you.
Against interstate, it is even within state the same thing is there. As you have mentioned, that it is to maintain the cross subsidy rather than to discriminate against state or other, that kind of thing. Even from within state, if you purchase, you need to pay this.
No.
So two things there. One thing is that in power exchanges, because all of it is collective transaction, because you don't know like which state is like which from which generator is supplying electricity to which supplier, like buyer.
Because it comes into a grid.
It's a combined grid, and you don't know whether it's a local supply or it's a supply from outside. So like that differentiation doesn't exist.
So therefore it is only for cross state.
It is, but the thing is that most of the power is coming from different states. Like Chhattisgarh is Chhattisgarh is one of the bigger suppliers. Gujarat is one of the bigger suppliers.
It's a slide which you had shown, slide number 12 about the low electricity access. If you will see all those states which are having 100% level, there the amount is maximum. The cross subsidy, like here Tamil Nadu, AP, West Bengal, and they are having low their electricity access is 100%. So that is the reason, and the states which are having low electricity access are having a very low, like Rajasthan, Himachal, Jharkhand.
Yeah, yeah. The point is that this impedes one market in power. That's the key point here, and therefore, you know, this is not something states impose exorbitant taxes on purchase from other states. We do not have one market in power. You know, of course, different states do it to different extents. Now, I think one of the really, really, you know, new challenges that's arisen in India, and probably all over the world. Actually, it's not just in India, but it's all over the world. What is happening because of technological change, but also because of government policy of subsidization, the price of renewables, 2011, 18 rupees per kilowatt hour. Today, it's just over 2. There are even some bids. So on the one hand, and these are the rates for wind. So on the one hand, this is terrific news for the consumer, because, you know, and for the environment. It's great news for the consumer and the environment. But as you know, that in the real world, there are no free lunches. There are some big challenges associated with that. I can think of at least one or two. One is, of course, I mean, I should maybe go to this and come back. You see, what has happened is that many of these PPAs, many of the power generation that happened, two kinds of challenges. One, there is at least now about 20 to 25,000 megawatts of power capacity that's been created, where the costs of that generation are well above now what current prices are. So those basically have become unviable. So it's just lying idle. And we don't know what's going to happen. I think the power minister has just set up a committee or to try and see what's going to happen. So a lot of capacity and all this capacity was created, some of it when oil prices were at 100 and whatever, $20 a barrel. And you saw, you know, even renewable, we thought was not very high, was very high, renewable costs were very high. And now we find that the world has changed. So this is for new capacity created with no contracts. But then you also have, what about capacity created where you've entered into these 25-year contracts, but then the buyer is now saying, why should I be locked into buying power at 5 and 6 rupees a kilowatt hour when today I can get it at 2.5-3 rupees a kilowatt hour? And to some extent, I think that challenge we see in recent litigation. You know, two big power generating companies had entered into long-term contracts with the DISCOM. For no fault of theirs, their coal supply from Indonesia got interrupted. So the input cost went up. They went to the regulator at APTEL and said, please, allow us to pass on these costs to the DISCOM because our input costs went up and we had nothing to do with it. The regulator said, fine, you can do it. But the Supreme Court finally, very recently, about a month or 2 months ago, said, no, if you had a contract, you have to do it on the original terms of the contract. So this is, I think, I don't know how this is going to be resolved. But this is, quite from an analytical point of view, it's very interesting. But from an actual practical point of view also, it's really very challenging. Suddenly, the cost of one source of power declines. You had all this capacity created at a time when the prices were very different. What should you do? You know, of course, I think in an ideal world, if we had, you know, good institutions, we would be able to maybe renegotiate some of these contracts. So this is one big challenge that's arisen with power today. And, you know, going forward, we're going to have to deal with it. So this is, I think, I cannot tell you what a very significant development this is, which has both its huge benefits, but also raises a whole set of complications. One number is that the, you know, the amount of capacity that we've created, thermal capacity, could involve loans of about 1 lakh crores. And so, you know, how do we do, is this going to add to the NPA problem that we spoke about earlier, is a big policy challenge as well. So I think that, you know, at least for a few years, I think you can teach, I think, the power sector to your students, which I think would make it really come alive, because lots of interesting, very topical and interesting things. Actually, you should also teach the telecom sector, because very interesting things are happening there. Okay, this is the last challenge. You know, people, this is, I think, in some ways, the irony in India today, that we have both excess demand, because remember, access to power is still not as much as it should be, although we've made great strides in doing 24/7 power. You still have a lot of states thing, but we also have excess capacity, excess supply. Plant load factors have declined very sharply. And so on the right, you see you know, declining plant load factors, which shows excess supply. On the left-hand side, you show, you know, still so many people need power. So that's excess demand. And this is where, I think this is how, one of the paradoxes about India today is that we have both excess demand and excess supply at the same time.
Generally, in infrastructure, we have PPP kind of projects. So, and these projects would be long term. Now, when you are mentioning about the risk that are involved in wrong terms, do you think the terms of agreements can change, because there would be external shocks and external?
Sure, but that's exactly what I was saying. That, you know, we need, given that these are, you know, whenever you have huge fixed costs, right, you have to have long term contracts. But if the market is very dynamic and lots of change happens, you know, those contracts become, you know, superseded. So essentially what we need is, how do we optimally renegotiate these contracts? And I think it's going to be very difficult. Well, let me finish and then we can do the question. So this is my last slide. I think in response to, you know, the problem of the DISCOM losses, 2 years ago, a year and a half ago, the government started a new scheme called UDAY. And basically what happened in UDAY is that the states took over the DISCOM debt and, you know, progressively they issued bonds instead. And so the DISCOMs now have less debt. They've been taken over by the states. It's kind of relief for them. But, you know, what they've done is, this relief is conditional on certain reforms that the DISCOMs have to enact. You know, they have to reduce AT&C losses. They have to do more metering, because essentially that, you know, we need, we can't have the same thing again and again, where basically that you, you know, we take over the debt, but you do nothing, no reforms. So that, because remember, we had a similar situation with the DISCOMs in the early 2000s as well. So this is a problem that keeps recurring. And in a sense, all of this, you know, there is a deep, deep political origin to all of this, which is actually very simple, but, you know, a kind of the first order fact, which is that if we want to provide, you know, power, free power, cheap power to, you know, a whole set of consumers, I mean, this is going to be intrinsic to that. So how do we figure out a way of, you know, this very deep political economy problem of, you know, being able to charge for power, so that, you know, in a, so that then you don't have to have losses, you may not have to have, or at least not to the same extent, and don't have to cross subsidize as well. I mean, the point, I mean, the high tariff, high industrial tariffs, I think if you do surveys of firms, especially the smaller firms, I didn't tell you, of course, one more thing, fact is that, so many firms, you know, of course, depending on size, they do different things. because they either get power at very expensive rates or the quality of power is not very good. They have their own generators. It could often be diesel powered generators. There, then what happens is that, of course, costs go up and environmental costs also go up as a result of that, because burning diesel is much more. So it leads to a lot of pathologies. I think that it's something that, you know, all governments have struggled with, but those are some of the root causes of the problem. And what you see here are some of the, you know, kind of the manifestations of these deeper problems. So thank you.